This is Spelunking the Deep, guaranteed queries on neural implicit surfaces via range analysis, and I'm Nick Sharp. Computing with 3D data is all about finding the right representation, from point clouds to voxel grids, tet meshes and triangle meshes, to spline, CSG trees and implicits and more. There are many different representations with various strengths and weaknesses. Today, we're going to look at a particularly promising kind of implicit surface representation and see some new computational tools that help us really unlock its power. The basic idea of implicit surfaces is to represent a shape via the level set of some function. This function takes 3D XYZ coordinates as input and produces a real number as output. And by convention, we say that the points where this function outputs a negative value are inside the shape. In neural implicit surfaces, this function is a neural network. These offer benefits from gradient-based optimization to excellent compression properties, latent and data-driven manipulation, and more. And more generally, these are part of a class of techniques called neural fields, which have been widely studied lately for the particular case of surfaces, and also more broadly for encoding visual and scientific data. Now remember, we have all of these representations for 3D data, and because there are many different tasks we want to apply them to, we've seen the emergence of a really wide range of different, sometimes quite complicated methods. For instance, optimizing 3D reconstruction with a triangle mesh might require a whole suite of remeshing tools, hierarchical solvers, heuristics, and so on. These neural implicit representations are exciting because for many of these tasks, they end up just being simple gradient-based descent on the weights of the neural network, and this is really appealing. This works so well that it's useful and being widely applied, even in cases where there's not really any machine learning going on per se. We just use this neural network as a function space to solve a single problem of interest. So not only do these neural implicit representations often easy optimization of many different objectives and many tasks by just minimizing some loss function, but they also adaptively represent varying complexity without explicit choices of discretization. They're easy to integrate with the machine learning toolbox when we do want to do so. Although there are some downsides, they require a great deal more computation in terms of just the number of floating point operations. And also, this is the real kicker, it can be difficult to make use of these representations for downstream tasks. And this last one is the one we're going to focus on today. So given all of these cases where we might want to use a neural implicit representation of a shape, how do we query that representation? For instance, how do we take a ray that we want to cast in space and find where it intersects the surface? Or given two of these neural implicit shapes, how do we test whether or not they overlap each other? The way this has been tackled in the past is by using what's called sign distance functions, or SDFs, where not only does our implicit function define the surface, but also its magnitude gives the distance to the surface. If you actually have a high quality, accurate sign distance function, then doing a lot of these geometric queries isn't so bad. But being limited to sign distance functions has a lot of downsides in the neural context. First, neural networks only ever approximately model SDFs, leading to robustness problems. And more deeply, this property only holds at the end of training, so you can't use it in loss functions, which you would need to apply at the beginning of training. And also, many computational tasks are just more naturally phrased on models for the surface other than sign distance functions. So all of this is to say is that we want to do queries and geometric operations on neural implicit surfaces, which are not necessarily sign distance functions. And this is the main task that we try to tackle in this work. We're not going to introduce any new architectures or any new loss functions or anything like that. We're going to give you new tools to compute with the neural networks you already have, which have already been fitted to all of these interesting tasks. And we'll provide a set of techniques that makes no particular assumptions about the function encoded by the neural network. So if we're going to analyze these kind of shape representations, we need a new tool at our disposal. Our tool is a decades-old technique from numerical computing called range analysis. Range analysis takes a function and a range of inputs to that function that we're interested in and computes bounds on the output of that function over the range. The most basic kind of range analysis is called interval arithmetic, where we take each scalar value in a computational expression and replace it with lower and upper bounds on the value over that range of inputs. Then, as we perform operations, we can push these bounds forward until we eventually get a bound on the output of our computation. So for instance, here are what some of these update rules look like if we're tracking bounds for upper and lower values on a scalar in interval arithmetic. So this is like an automatic function transformation. You can think of interval arithmetic or range analysis more broadly as being kind of like forward mode auto differentiation. But instead of automatically computing derivatives, we're going to automatically compute bounds on functions. This is the foothold that lets us start analyzing these implicit functions. We can take a region of space, do a forward evaluation of a network with range analysis, and get at a bound on the value of our neural net over that region. So for instance, if this bound is greater than zero, then it tells us that that entire region is certainly strictly outside the shape, no matter how crazy the function encoded by a neural network might be. So this lets us start building up geometric queries. However, it's not quite that easy in our case, because although the bounds from any kind of range analysis are always guaranteed to be valid bounds, in the sense that they really do contain the function output on the region of interest, they might not necessarily be tight bounds, in the sense that they could be much looser bounds than the set of values the function actually spans. And indeed, if we naively apply this interval arithmetic technique to neural networks, we get bounds that are so loose they're totally useless due to cancellation that happens inside the linear layers. Fortunately, if we dig a bit deeper, there are more advanced forms of range analysis beyond interval arithmetic. And in particular, we make use of affine arithmetic. You can think of affine arithmetic as being like a first order upgrade of interval arithmetic, where we track linearizations of error quantities for intermediate values inside of the network. This is still a fully automatic arithmetic scheme, but even better, it has the property that it automatically preserves bounds under affine operations, like the linear layers in our network. In the end, these affine arithmetic operations provide a very effective trade-off between reasonably tight bounds on our function and modest computational overhead. A big technical component of this work was doing an empirical study to find just the right version of affine arithmetic, which is effective on these kinds of neural networks that we use to represent implicit surfaces. So we condense all of this down into a subroutine, which takes a neural network representing some implicit surface and a bounded region of inputs that we're interested in, and tells us that the network output on that region is either strictly positive, strictly negative, or not necessarily either. We implement this routine, as well as the high-level geometric queries to come, in a machine learning framework, along with some tricks for efficient vectorized GPU implementations. The most standard query that we want to build using this range analysis is, as I mentioned before, casting array in space and testing where they intersect the shape, most often used to generate images when rendering an implicit surface. Here's a visualization of this happening. These blue figures that I show are all implicit neural network, which I fit with a variety of different activations and objective functions. In this case, it's an occupancy function, not a sine distance function. If we want to march this ray forward in space to cast it into the surface, we can first analyze this interval shown here. And sure enough, range analysis tells us that it's strictly outside the shape, so we can march forward. If we test this interval, well, maybe our range analysis is a little bit too pessimistic with its bounds, so we don't see that it's outside of shape. But if we try a smaller interval, we're good to go, and we can continue marching and marching and marching until eventually this ray converges to the shape. With this, we're able to render this image like I show here, and the plot on the right shows the number of steps that this ray casting procedure takes. We can also push this a step further and use spatial analyses of 3D volumes to push an entire frustum of rays forward at once by looking at bundles of pixels in image space. This spatial acceleration hierarchically accelerates the procedure for high-resolution data. Now remember, here we're working with implicit functions which do not necessarily have any special structure. Without our method, the only recourse would be to cast rays using small, fixed-size steps. But taking large steps leads to errors, like you see on the left, whereas taking very small steps would be prohibitively expensive. And our approach is better than either. To really put this range analysis to work, we can use it to construct spatial acceleration hierarchies, like KD trees, over our implicit surfaces. In these KD trees, each cell represents a region of 3D space, and we use range analysis to bound the function in that region as strictly inside or outside the surface. If a cell straddles the surface or range analysis is ambiguous, we recurse into a smaller cell. Here's a visualization of one of these trees. The yellow cells are all nodes of the KD tree classified as strictly outside the implicit shape. The purple cells are ambiguous. We would need to keep refining to classify them. It's interesting to notice that the ReLU activation leads to planes of uncertainty shooting out into space. Although if we refine farther, we would indeed classify these nodes just like the others. This data structure makes it easy to implement a whole range of efficient volumetric queries, all following standard procedures in geometry processing, but now we're able to do them on neural implicit surfaces. A first common operation is sampling points on or near the surface, which shows up often in geometric loss functions. Here, rather than uniformly rejection sampling from all of space, we can sample only from the nodes of this KD tree which are near the surface. This yields dramatic speedups, and importantly, it still yields the exact same result. It's not an approximation strategy, it's just an acceleration. Similarly, we can also perform fast mesh extraction by running the marching cube algorithm only on the leaves of the KD tree and skipping any nodes which we know to be empty. Once again, this gives order of magnitude speedup at high resolution while still provably producing the exact same result as running dense marching cubes. We can also come back to this question of intersection and test whether two shapes overlap by building a combined KD tree where we discard any node which is strictly outside of either shape. The result is either a guarantee that the two shapes do not overlap or some point in their intersection. And one more of these, we can use the KD tree to perform closest point queries, where here on the right, each black point is a query point in space, and the red point is the corresponding nearest point on the neural implicit level set found by searching the spatial KD tree. We can do this either explicitly, building the whole tree ahead of time, or implicitly by lazily constructing only the subset of the tree we need. So wrapping all of this up, we saw how we can use range analysis to bound the output of an implicit neural network in a region of space. And this enables us to perform geometric queries and build spatial hierarchies. To be clear, this is still slower than the fastest SDF-based methods, but that's because it's a much more general method, which applies even to randomly initialized networks and offers provable guarantees of accuracy. Also, in this work, we focus mainly on simple MLP-like architectures, but the core idea could generalize to almost any neural network architecture. There's a lot to do. With that, I'll wrap up. See the link here for the paper, code, and more. Thanks.